Tonight, Howard K. Stern in his first live primetime interview since the shocking death of Anna Nicole. And his court clash with Larry Burkhead over baby Danny Lynn's paternity. It's a tabloid saga that won't go away, spawning conspiracy theories and multi-million-dollar lawsuits. A sensational book accuses Stern and Larry Burkhead of a sexual encounter and ugly scheming. But does an astonishing audio undercut at least some of the author's claims?
I know, but I do think it's important to speak with them, and then also to give credibility to them, and I also think...
So you want to validate what you put in the book, basically. That's what we're doing, right?
This is a high-stakes, high-drama scandal. Reputations, millions of dollars, and the future of an innocent little girl on the line. Howard K. Stern on the attack. He's here, he's next, on Larry King Live. Howard is joined here in New York by his famed attorney from Atlanta, Lynn Wood. This is Howard's, as we said, first primetime interview since the shocking death of Anna on February 8th of this year. It's also his first interview since the release of Rita Cosby's controversial book, Blonde Ambition, The Untold Story Behind Anna Nicole Smith's Death, and the filing of his $60 million libel suit against Rita and her publisher. Howard has filed a defamation suit against John O'Quinn as well. O'Quinn has been the attorney for Anna Nicole's mom, Virgie Arthur. And as if that weren't enough, Virgie has filed a defamation suit against Howard. How you doing with all you, what a year.
It's been a nightmare. I can't even really describe in words how difficult that it's been to lose Anna, to lose Daniel, and then not even really to have a chance to mourn with everything that everybody said in the media, all these just lies by people who are complete frauds.
Was the book a shock?
The book was a shock. You know, I didn't know that Rita Cosby was writing a book. She's somebody who I've never talked to. And then when the claims came out in that book, the book really should start Once Upon a Time because it's just total fiction.
So she never asked to interview you?
She never asked to interview me.
Before we move into other things, Lynn, isn't that surprising in a case when someone does a book, don't they usually ask?
It's an egregious breach of basic journalism.
Usually ask to interview the person.
Ask to interview to give him an opportunity to respond. Larry Burkhead, she also did not ask to interview Larry Burkhead. She turned a head away from the truth, Larry. She didn't want to face it.
We're going to talk about Anna's death and all that's followed. First, let's go back to your appearance on this show, Howard, on September 26, 2006. Anna was still alive, had recently given birth, and you came on and dropped this bombshell. Watch.
Anna and I have been in a relationship, and we love each other, and it's been going on for a very long time. And because of my relationship as her lawyer, we felt that it was best to keep everything hidden. And we've actually done a pretty good job of that.
Sure have. So you are the father?
Yes, sir.
By the way, have there been any DNA tests taken? Is that
proud a father?
What?
I said proud father.
Were DNA tests taken?
Well, based on the timing of when the baby was born, there really is no doubt in either of our minds.
All right, Howard, were you kidding me, or did you believe that at the time?
No, we really believed that Danny Lynn was conceived in December, and if she was, she would have been mine. And so, I honestly believed it.
So what was wrong in your thinking? Did you have the timing wrong?
We did. We had the timing wrong.
Were you shocked when the DNA results came in?
I was shocked. I was shocked, but I was thinking of Danny Lynn, and I do want the best for Danny Lynn. My feelings for Danny really hadn't changed, and from that point forward, I committed myself to work with Larry to do whatever I can to make sure that she has a happy life.
But you and Anna Nicole were lovers.
Absolutely. Okay.
Also, you and Anna were on this show together in February of 2004, and I asked about your relationship. Watch. Howard, she looks terrific. She says she's too slim. Do you think so?
I think she's hot. She looks beautiful. She looks absolutely beautiful.
Are you, do you two date? Do you two date? I know he's your attorney. Anna, do you date Howard?
No.
I wish.
Where did those rumors come from?
Which ones?
That you, about you and Howard?
From everybody.
I think we just spend so much time together that people think that.
Howard, what kind of client is Anna Nicole Smith?
She's the best. I have a dream job. She's the absolute best.
With her,
well, she's my best friend, so it doesn't feel like work. It's my life. I love it.
So at that time, you weren't intimate?
No, we were.
We were
kidding at that time. It was a relationship that we hid.
Back to the baby business, Howard. If you were so sure, you should have done a DNA right there, right? Saved a lot of time.
Well, what people don't understand is that I was not named as a party up until the time that Anna passed away. And from when Anna did pass away, I did try and reach out to Larry to resolve this and get a DNA test done privately. And it wasn't Larry, I think, that shut it down. I think it was through his attorneys. I received a letter saying that if I talked to Larry personally, that they would get a restraining order against me.
We have an email question from Mandy in Palos Heights, Illinois. What kind of father do you think Larry Burkhead is for Daniel Lynn?
You know, I saw Larry and Danny Lynn a couple days ago, and Danny Lynn is completely bonded to Larry. Larry loves her. I think he's doing a great job. I think, he couldn't be doing a better job. And that's why when I hear criticism out there about Larry not being a good father, it's from people who have never met Larry, never seen Larry and Danny Lynn interact. It's just unfair.
So, and you have no jealousy of that relationship? Even though you were the first one with her.
Well, I wish I was Danny Lynn's father, but I'm not. Larry's Danny Lynn's father, and I still want her to have a great life, like I was saying. So I'm going to do whatever I can to support Larry in his role as a father.
You think your client Lynn has been preyed upon?
I think they've taken a man that was a loving companion to Anna Nicole Smith, and they have turned him into being one of the most vilified individuals in this country. And they have done it for their own publicity and primarily for their own profit. So yes, he's absolutely been preyed upon.
When you were on that show in 2004 with Anna, I asked why you didn't sue over false tabloid stories. There were so many about you, about her. And you said it was because lawsuits take years, and once you sue, it just keeps issues in the news over and over. So why sue now?
Well, for two reasons, really. I don't think that Anna Nicole can really rest in peace until this is cleared up. I think that what has happened is completely unfair to her, it's unfair to me, and most important, it's unfair to Danny Lynn. I don't want Danny Lynn, when she's 15, to be reading this and to think that this is who her mother was, because it's just outright lies.
Is the book in the main lies?
The book?
Yeah.
Oh, the book accuses me of every crime in the world, barring jaywalking, I think, and that's probably the only one I'd be guilty of.
Rita describes her book as the tell-all book. I would describe it accurately as the tell-all lies book. It is a lie.
We're going to go to break. We received the following statement from Rita Cosby, author of Blonde Ambition. She said, quote, I am certainly not surprised that Howard K. Stern denies certain statements in the book. However, this does not change the fact that the statements in the book are based on thorough investigation, extensive court documents, and other published reports, as well as statements provided by many reliable and credible sources. These sources include former and current law enforcement officials. On two separate occasions, we've requested that Howard K. Stern provide us with any facts that support his allegations that certain statements are not truthful, and to date, he has yet to set forth any such facts. We'll ask Howard about that, as well as Lynn Wood, when we come back.
Lynn to have a loving environment, and he was, regardless of our differences, a big part of Anna's life, and I think Anna would have wanted that, so I'm just
and
trying
he
to,
loved her.
He loved her, and I'm just trying to carry out, you know, Anna's wishes.
And he loved Anna and Nicole, too.
Yes.
So he loved the daughter and the mother.
He asked about her, he writes emails and calls and asks about how the daughter's doing and Dane Lynn, you know, so.
We're back. You want to respond, Lynn, to that statement by Ms. Cosby?
I can tell you that her publisher sent me a letter asking for us to advise them of the inaccuracies in the story, and I basically responded and said, we'll let you know about that when we file the complaint. But if you look at what she said in that statement, for example, to see how she turns things into what I call smoke and mirrors, she makes reference to having two law enforcement officers, right, former law enforcement officers as sources. One of those is an investigator who works for John O'Quinn, who, as you know, Howard has filed a slander case against. The other so-called former law enforcement official was a former deputy sheriff in Los Angeles who works as an investigator for Deborah Opry, the lawyer that's now in the contentious litigation with Larry Burkhead and has obviously been very adverse to Howard from day one. Those are the kinds of sources, good examples of the biased, non-reliable sources that she used in this book should not have been done.
You have a lot of lawsuits, quite a few lawsuits. How many you got, three?
Well, we got two that we filed for Howard, and we learned yesterday that Virgie Arthur has now filed a lawsuit against him in Texas.
And you, so you have to answer to that.
We will.
Yeah. One of the lawsuits against Rita Cosby and her publisher in connection with Rita's book, Blonde Ambition. We have this statement from the publisher. Maybe you'll comment. We've received the complaint and are reviewing the allegations contained within the complaint. Have no comment at this time. However, as previously stated, we continue to stand behind the book, which was thoroughly researched by an experienced journalist. How do you react to that?
Well, she certainly didn't contact me about it. And, you know, I lived it, and I know what the truth is. So she certainly didn't do enough research. I mean, I personally think that she knew when she wrote this book that these were false allegations.
Are you saying she had an agenda?
I absolutely feel she had an agenda.
All right, let's deal with it. One of the most sensational claims in Blonde Ambition, the one that's gotten the most press, is that you and Larry Burkhead had a sexual encounter.
Totally false.
Only you and Larry know that.
Totally false. Totally false.
Does she describe where it took place? What the circumstances were? Is it a once-only thing? What does she say? I didn't see the book.
Well, from what she said publicly and also from the book, she relies on Jackie Hatton for one statement. And Jackie Hatton was out of Anna's life. She was a friend for a brief period of time and out of Anna's life when her brother was arrested for beating up a neighbor and for making criminal threats against Anna and then later convicted.
So you're saying unequivocally not true?
Unequivocally not.
Ms. Jackie Hatton has been a guest on this show. And she's a friend of Anna Nicole's, she says. The book says that Jackie claims she and Anna saw you and Larry in a compromising position in Los Angeles. The book also says Jackie claims that Anna told her that you were gay.
Totally false. Totally false. I don't believe Anna would have ever said that because it's false. And Jackie Hatton was never in the same room with Larry and myself. Absolutely impossible. Jackie was out of Anna's life before Anna met Larry. Totally false.
She was never in the same state where Larry Burkhead and Howard Stern were together. She never met Larry Burkhead until after Anna Nicole had died.
So how do you...
I don't even think she's met Larry Burkhead to this day.
How do you account for this?
Well,
she just made up...
Well, you know, if you look at the history of Jackie Hatton's interviews, which were readily available for Rita Cosby to see, you'll find that she's told a number of inconsistent and contradictory statements about Anna Nicole and about Howard. And if you look at the history of her brother, Mark Hatton, who is now in prison after he was arrested and convicted of terroristic threats and an assault on a neighbor of Anna Nicole's, you'll find that Jackie Hatton ended a friendship, Anna Nicole ended that friendship in 2001, and Anna Nicole never had any contact with Jackie Hatton until she showed up in the Bahamas after Daniel's death and tried to get in touch with her. Anna Nicole wanted her off of the island. Jackie Hatton physically could not have witnessed an event at a home in Los Angeles.
You have to say, then, you were whacked out, totally shocked by this.
Absolutely, absolutely. I mean, the whole thing is just purely fictional, absolutely fictional. And that's why I say this had to have been done with people with an agenda. You know, Jackie Hatton, I don't know how many interviews that she did about me, but I saw it, and she was not pulling any punches. And
there she is.
If for one second she thought that Larry and I had any sort of sexual relationship, she would have said that front and center.
We have a statement from her. We'll read it and get more, lots more to go on the program tonight with Howard K. Stern and Lynn Wood. Stephen Colbert tomorrow night. Don't go away. We're back. We received a contact to Jackie Hatton about tonight's interview. Asked if she wanted to provide a statement. This is what she gave us. I continue to mourn the premature deaths of my dear friend Anna Nicole and godson Daniel Wayne Smith. I anxiously await the inquest into Daniel's suspicious death, which is scheduled to start in the Bahamas on October 30th, 2007. Was his death suspicious?
Well, I think what the Bahamas said is that any time that a youngster dies, and it's not through like a car accident or something, some obvious death, that it would be considered suspicious.
Cosby's book also claims there's a videotape, which she concedes she never saw, that shows Howard and Larry engaged in gay sex. How do you respond to that?
It's totally impossible.
There's a tape, I never saw it.
It's totally impossible. And if Rita Cosby really thought that there was a tape, she should have tried to watch it. You don't rely on other people's words for something as salacious as that. It's just completely impossible. The act never occurred. No tape can exist.
And why print it?
Well, because you got to understand, and I think you do, the nature of the business. If Rita Cosby doesn't publish this sensational headline about some sexual relationship between Larry Burkhead and Howard, she's got no book that's going to sell, because it's just a run-of-the-mill, tell the same old rumors again type book. That's what got the headlines. That's what got the book sold. That's what she was trying to do for profit. That was why she put that out there, and she knew that that would generate the publicity. Look at what Jackie Hatton did not say. The statement she gave you, she didn't say she stood behind this alleged story of seeing Howard and Larry together. And look at what happened this week in the Bahamas. The lawyer for the nannies, who allegedly saw the video and told John O'Quinn's investigator they had seen it, who then told Rita that it existed, triple hearsay, They've come out through their lawyer and said that they never made that statement to the investigator.
If I may say, the other thing about Jackie's statement is she says that she was Daniel's godmother. I've also heard her say that she's Danny Lynn's godmother. She absolutely is neither of their god. She's not a godmother. Absolutely not.
CNN has obtained an audio tape of what purports to be a recent conversation between Rita Cosby and Elizabeth Thompson, an attorney for the two nannies you mentioned, I believe, formerly employed by Anna Nicole Smith in the Bahamas. The book Blonde Ambition claims these two nannies told private investigators that Anna Nicole loved to watch a gay sex video of Howard K. Stern and Larry Burkhead. Let's listen to a brief excerpt.
Yeah, but why did you want to speak with them after the fact? After you've already written the book, why do you want to speak to them about those issues?
Because I think it's important to speak with them.
To whom?
Well, to them and to you. You know, that's why.
It's not to me. I'm not the client.
No,
it's not my information.
I know, but I do think it's important to speak with them, and then also to give credibility to them, and I also think.
So you want to validate what you put in the book, basically. That's what we're doing here, right?
Well, that's some of it, but I also think. Can I tell you also? We also have separate than them. We have other people in the book. So
of
I'm comfortable.
Course, but what
I'm
is in the book?
Let me tell you,
the book they feature prominently in this book. I mean, I've highlighted.
Well,
number of the pages where they feature, and no one has spoken to them about this. It blows my mind.
Well, that's why I came here. That's why I came here.
You came to validate the information that you already got.
Well,
for your book.
Well, I have information elsewhere, just so you're aware. But I do think.
Okay, so page 204, you had that information elsewhere.
Yes.
That they said this, and the presence of their attorney, who would be me. I wasn't anywhere.
Well,
I'm not aware of this.
Well, I'm here to speak to them about it. That's important.
That's important to you.
No, absolutely.
And it's not important to them, to be honest. It's not important to them. It's important to you.
No, absolutely.
So my question is, what do you want? What you want, then, is in relation to this $15,000 of the magazine? Is that what you're saying? These are the expenses being paid through the magazine and not through you, because you can't do it.
Exactly.
And this tape was recorded earlier this week in the Bahamas. Your reaction?
At this point, nothing that Rita Cosby does surprises me. The book should be pulled from the shelf. Well, honestly, this is the first time I've heard that tape, so I don't want to make too many comments on it.
Are you surprised?
No, because I know that these allegations in this book are false. It's not just the sex allegation. The whole book is garbage. So nothing that Rita Cosby does would surprise me.
But look at what Rita's statement said, claiming that she did a thorough investigation. Now, last time I checked, there were tickets to the Bahamas where she could have flown down there before that book was published. And yet she didn't go down there until this week after she got sued. She was telling that lawyer, it's so important that I talk to these nannies. The time to talk to those nannies would have been before she published the book. But if she had gone down there, they would have told her it didn't happen. She couldn't have had the sensational headlines, and she doesn't get the profit.
We have a statement from one of the nannies. Regarding both of them, the nannies never spoke to Rita Cosby before the book was written and indeed did not speak to private investigators relative to any allegations of homosexual acts which may or may not have occurred between Howard K. Stern and Larry Burkhead.
There it is.
That's pretty definitive.
All a lie.
That's pretty definitive.
All a lie. And this man has to live with it for the rest of his life. And one day, Danny Lynn's going to read that book or be told about that book. And that's one of the reasons I think Howard wants to pursue these lawsuits, so that when that day comes, he can at least look at her and said, I tried to get the truth out, because
that's
part of what this lawsuit is about.
You know, that's absolutely the reason. I want the truth to come out, and that's why I filed a lawsuit against John O'Quinn, and that's why I filed a lawsuit against Rita Cosby, because I cannot live with myself knowing that this is what people believe right now. And it's not fair to Anna, it's not fair to her memory, and it's certainly not fair to Danny Lynn.
As we go to break, a reminder that Rita Cosby in her statement stands by the contents of her book. And now, where exactly was Howard when Anna Nicole died? That and a lot more when Larry King Live returns.
New photo of the dramatic moment, Rita Cosby, the former MSNBC correspondent, arriving for her own book release party when she is handed the papers that accuse her of publishing lies. Rita arrives, the server emerges, hits her with the documents.
This is all about publicity. Look where he did it.
Now here's a look at the lawsuit handed to Rita and filed by Howard K. Stern. Howard refuting claims in Rita's book that he engaged in a homosexual act with Larry Burkhead and that he conspired to kill Anna Nicole.
We're back with Howard K. Stern, the longtime companion of the late, hard to say that, late Anna Nicole, and Lynn Wood, the famed Atlanta attorney who represents Mr. Stern in these lawsuits. The publication In Touch was mentioned in that audio we just played. We contacted the magazine. Here's what they said. We were approached by a party about paying to speak to Anna Nicole's nannies. We said we wouldn't pay for the story, but would be interested in talking to them and maybe open to licensing photos of the nannies with Anna Nicole. What do you make of that?
Again, you know, nothing that Rita Cosby says or does would surprise me, and this is In Touch refuting even what Rita Cosby told the lawyer for the nannies.
You can bet the party that approached In Touch was representing Rita Cosby if it was not Rita.
She probably had
a middle person go out and pitch it. She was trying to find a way to get money to be able to go down there, it appears, to make some sort of financial offer to these folks to talk to her.
Let's move on to some other allegations that you want to address. Anna and drug use. Her cause of death was determined to be an accidental overdose of prescription drugs. Do you feel any responsibility, any coulda, woulda, shoulda guilt about her passing?
You know, I think everybody lives with certain regrets. And with Anna, there are certain things I wish I had never gone to go get that boat. There were prescriptions that were made for Anna, but they were put in my name to protect her privacy. But they were through doctors trying to look out for her health. I really, truly believe that Anna, she could survive everything. She was a fighter, but she just could not survive the death of her son. That's
that
what I
killed
believe.
Her?
Well, obviously Dr. Perper said that it was an accidental drug combination that killed her. But I, in my heart, I believe that Anna could not survive the death of her son. She was tormented, absolutely tormented by the death of her son.
When did you last see her, Howard?
When I went to go get the boat.
Where was she?
She was in bed. She was in bed. She was sleeping in bed.
She had a flu-like or just sleeping?
She was actually getting better. She had a flu when we got to Florida, but she was getting better. She was sleeping.
Where were you when she died?
Well, I found out that she died when I was able to go to the hospital.
Was taken to the hospital?
She was taken to the hospital.
And someone summoned you to go to the hospital?
Right.
I mean, like, who told you?
Well, when I came back, obviously I got a call when I was on the boat from Mo that something was wrong and that he was going to call 911. And I immediately went back to the hotel room. And when I got to the hotel room, there were emergency medical people there, and they wouldn't let me go in. And they wouldn't let me go to the hospital with Anna. I was just, you know, I was inconsolable. I didn't know what was going on. And when they finally let me go to the hospital, right when I got there is when I learned that she had died. And then they let me go in to spend some time with her and get a priest to give her her last rites.
You spent some time with her after she passed away?
Absolutely.
Were you, I don't mean this negatively, obsessed with her?
Anna was my world. You know, I worshipped
obsessed.
Her. I worshipped her. To me, her happiness was more important than my own. And
wow.
you can say whatever you want about that, but I got my happiness from her being happy.
One of the blonde ambition allegations that you're suing over involves the claim that you used cocaine yourself and supplied cocaine to Anna Nicole.
Absolutely false.
Do you know how she verifies that at all in the book?
I don't, but it's absolutely false.
She makes some reference in the book to unnamed hotel workers who claimed that they had seen some white powder when they were cleaning the rooms. I mean, there it is. I mean, you start using sources like that, and Jackie Hatton, and these biased investigators. You know what all that adds up to, Larry? We call it reckless disregard for the truth. You don't publish those kinds of allegations without legitimate sources and corroboration before you put out statements that are clearly, knowingly going to impugn someone's reputation, hold them up to public ridicule, contempt, and scorn.
It's not fair to me, it's not fair to Anna, it's not fair to Danny Lynn.
Have you used illegal drugs at all?
In college, I smoked marijuana, and I'll admit to that.
Did Anna use illegal drugs?
No, she wasn't. She through doctors, got some prescription medications for ailments that she did have. And when people criticize her, people are trying to make it seem like Anna was drugged out for 12 years since I knew her, and that's absolutely false. It's absolutely false.
I'm glad you're getting the chance to respond. Earlier this year on this program, Jackie Hatton, the aforementioned Ms. Hatton, claimed she'd seen you providing drugs to Anna Nicole. Let's take a look.
I've witnessed Howard give her Vicodin, Valium, Finagrin, morphine, Demerol. Shall I go on? I mean, it's too much for someone to take over a period of time. That's considered aggravated death. You know what I'm saying? Accumulated effect over the years, whether he gave it to her the last second or not, it's just not acceptable.
Would your guess be that the final results of the autopsy would show that?
I'm sure it will. That's
why
my
was
opinion.
He do it? Why was he giving her that? He's supposed to care for her a great deal. Why
my friend became his cash cow. I witnessed her become a cash cow.
If she had a lot of money, you had a lawsuit there.
That's true. If she had money, I'd have a lawsuit, but I don't think she has any money, frankly. And
well, did you see that, or did you hear about it? Were you shocked by it?
At the time that a lot of those interviews were going on, I couldn't even watch TV. I was too depressed. I did go back and I read transcripts to a lot of things, so I've seen the transcripts that people have said things. Jackie Hatton claimed to have known Anna since 1990. In 1990, Anna was in Texas. She was a dancer. She hadn't even met Howard Marshall. Jackie Hatton, virtually everything that she says is false.
What would lead her, do you think, to say something like that?
15 minutes of fame. This is her chance to come out and be on television, do interviews. Plain and simple.
No other reason.
If Jackie Hatton had been the friend that she claims to be, don't you think somebody would have seen or heard of her before now? And once her brother was in jail for doing what he did, do you really think that Anna would spend time with this woman? She just, Jackie Hatton.
We'll be right back with Howard K. Stern and Lynn Wood on this edition of Larry King Live. Don't go away. We're back on this illuminating program tonight. A home video of Anna became public after her death. It was played during the court battle in Florida. The tape showed Anna heavily pregnant, wearing face paint and behaving oddly. Many said she might be under the influence of something. Howard shot this video. We're seeing it now. What's your explanation of this, Howard? Just goofing off?
Well, that's a stolen video from the house, and it's about an hour-long video. And what they did is they cut it down into about 45 seconds to make it appear that Anna's on drugs, when in reality, Anna is pretending to be a little girl. And she, I think in the video, she even says that her name is Lucy, which is a character that she played in her most recent movie called Illegal Aliens. She's clearly playing around with a little girl, and it's just edited to make me look bad and to make Anna look bad. It's horrible.
Authorities said that some of the prescription medications found in her room had your name on them, but you already said that, right?
That's true. Yeah. That's true, but they were prescribed for Anna. There was no illusion about that.
And recently, two very disturbing photos of Anna Nicole started circulating. Some even call one of them a death photo. We've obtained two more photos from Howard that he says put the disturbing images in context. How you want to describe this for us, Howard?
And again, it's the same thing with the clown video. It's stolen. These are stolen pictures, and somebody released two selective pictures in order to make Anna appear bad and to make me appear bad. And there are pictures that are taken literally seconds apart that show what they are. One of them is Anna eating a Kentucky Fried Chicken sandwich, and with, I hate to say it, but Anna was not exactly the neatest of all eaters. And she's playing around for the camera, and she's making a face, a little pouty face that she makes. And she knows the pictures are being taken, and they're fun. They're not supposed to be released to the media. We never would have. But somebody stole it, released it to the media in order to make her look bad. The other picture is with her and Danny Lynn when she's sitting in the nursery. And it was a series of about 15 or 16 pictures. And they selected the one picture where Anna had a strange facial expression to make it appear that Anna was on drugs. When there's another picture taken literally a second earlier that shows that it's night and day. And the question is, why are these people trying to manipulate reality to make Anna look bad, make me look bad, and then also make Danny Lynn think that Anna was around her on drugs all the time, which is false?
How did they come public?
Stolen pictures.
For money?
Well, you know, I can't say, but I do believe I know who stole them. I do believe I know who released them.
You do?
I think I do.
Would you guess it was for money, Lynn? What else would it be for?
Well, I know for a fact firsthand that an individual tried to sell one photo, which unfortunately has now apparently come up on the internet in the last day or two, a picture of Anna Nicole and Daniel after he died.
That was after he died.
There was an effort to sell that by an individual for money. And I think that same individual was behind the release of these photographs, kind of teasing it because he thought he had more and he could get paid for it.
I'd actually like to comment on that one picture because I've been criticized for, I was the one who took that picture, and it was a time, obviously Daniel had just died. Anna was inconsolable. She didn't believe that Daniel had died, and she wanted me to take a picture of her with Daniel as proof that Daniel had died. It's not something that I wanted to do, but at that point, I literally would have run through a brick wall if I thought it could make Anna feel better. For someone now to try and sell that, when it's only something for Anna, and nobody else was meant to ever look at that.
When we come back, we'll have a statement from Big Mo, who's been on this show, Anna's former bodyguard, about some of the pictures he took and the circumstances around them. Quite a program tonight. Let's check in with Anderson Cooper. He'll host AC360 at the top of the hour. Anderson, what's up?
Larry, we're monitoring breaking developments in Cleveland tonight as new details emerge in today's school shooting. We're learning more about the troubled teen who opened fire and then killed himself, about warning signs that people apparently didn't act on. We'll get the latest from authorities in Cleveland, from a correspondent who's been exploring the shooter's neighborhood, as well as a perspective from an expert on spotting trouble before it's too late. Also tonight, new developments in that mystery at sea. Four crew members apparently killed. Now new charges against the two survivors. Also tonight, a 360 exclusive, will be premiering a new song by R.E.M. and talking with bandleader Michael Stipe, all in connection with their upcoming Planet in Peril series. A whole lot more, Larry, at the top of the hour.
Anderson, I can envision you doing some sort of special on the killing of children, which seems to be an epidemic.
It is, especially, I mean, we did that in Chicago, where so many kids from public schools are getting killed. It's youth violence around the country is up, Larry.
Anderson Cooper, 10 Eastern, 7 Pacific. We'll be right back with more of Howard K. Stern and Lynn Wood. Don't go away. Looking back at the photos we saw, we asked Big Mo, Anna Nicole's former bodyguard, Mo Brightwright, for a comment about the photos and the accusations made against him. This is a key part of the statement his spokesman gave us. All accusations concerning distribution and theft of the photos in question are false. Mr. Stern's 360 spin regarding Big Mo seems to be a calculated diversion. Lynn Wood's statement regarding Big Mo admitting distribution of the photos was another example of fiction, not fact.
Wrong. I know that Big Mo tried to sell photos. I know it from firsthand information. The photo of Anna Nicole and Daniel after his death.
Oh,
we also know, as a matter of fact, that Mo had the camera card from Anna Nicole's camera and her videotape recorder, which he took from the hotel room and to this day has refused to return. So Big Mo and whoever this guy Paul Porter is that's trying to go out and sell those pictures, that's not the truth.
Howard, on your behalf, why take photos like you took?
Well, look,
you
Anna
know they're going to get out. You know,
Anna took a lot of pictures around the house, and you know when you take a series of maybe 15 or 20 pictures, I don't think there's a person in the world who's not going to have one bad picture out of those series. And in this case, that's what was released, and that's what I don't understand. And in terms of videos, Anna was releasing videos on her website, so a lot of things were videoed. And these things were all stolen from the house, and they were aired out of context.
How did you fight off the image? And you had a rough image of being the attorney with one client, living off someone else. How did you respond to those?
Well, the thing is, Anna and I, we were best friends. We had a relationship. But I also did a lot of legal work for her. And I didn't take money from her that I would have been entitled to. And if I had accepted that money, I'd have a lot more money now than I do, which is
nothing. So how did you support yourself?
Back then? Well, look, Anna bought my clothes. She paid my rent. But I'll tell you, that is not, it's not even close to what I would have been entitled to if I had accepted the money from her, from the contracts I negotiated, from the legal cases that I
did. Did you inherit anything from her?
No, absolutely not. I'm not a beneficiary of the will.
You're not executor of the estate?
I'm the executor of the estate, and I waived compensation as executor of the estate.
And what about monies from the estate of her late husband?
We have obviously litigation that's now in the Ninth Circuit, and my firm would be entitled to 6% of that, but that would have been whether she was alive or, look, I would trade that for her being alive right now.
Of course. And what are you doing now to make a living?
Well, unfortunately, right now, it's not like I can go out and get a 9-to-5 job based on everything that's been said about me out there. So I'm very fortunate to have a family who's supporting me emotionally and financially at this point.
An email from Jessica in St. Petersburg, Florida. Do you ever plan to write a book or maybe produce a documentary about Anna Nicole? Not a bad idea.
You know, I had said before that there's no way in the world that I would do that because Anna didn't like people making money off of her in life, and I know she wouldn't approve of it in death, but the only way that I would do something like that is just to set everything straight.
That's what I mean.
It would be after these lawsuits, after everything comes out. It's possible, but right now I don't have any plans.
We'll be back with some more moments with Howard K. Stern and Lynn Wood right after this.
When was the last time you earned your own income?
I had a law practice.
What year?
Oh, until 2002. Anna paid for most things. She paid for everything, basically.
When you bought a pair of shoes, who paid for that?
I didn't buy too many pairs of shoes, but she did.
Did she give you a credit card?
No.
She would give you cash?
Yes.
Counsel Neil McCabe provided it. Mr. Stern will find that he has made a mistake like the one that Oscar Wilde made in beginning a prosecution for libel. That is, Mr. Stern. Mr. Stern is going to have to testify under oath and face facts under rigorous and unrelenting questioning. He cannot handle the truth.
Well, I have absolutely nothing to hide, and that's why I filed this lawsuit. And my question back to Mr. McCabe would be, if they're so... If they really want to get the truth out there, then why are they filing motions to dismiss, saying that what John O'Quinn said was rhetorical hyperbole and not meant to be taken seriously?
I've had many clients in defamation cases, and I've heard that same old threat over and over again. We're going to depose them under oath. We're going to get to the truth. Mm-hmm. Howard has nothing to hide. He's prepared to be deposed.
The most embarrassing facts about me are already out.
One more quick thing I want to get in. We asked Virgie Arthur, Anna Nicole's mother, for a statement in connection with tonight's interview. We got this from Neil McCabe, same Neil McCabe, who's representing the other lawyer. He's representing Virgie, and he said, the lawsuit we filed yesterday says enough for now. That is, Mr. Stern got Anna Nicole under the influence of drugs to say terrible, untrue, and hurtful things. He knew better. He should be ashamed of himself.
You know, Virgie Arthur was at Rita Cosby's book party, and she was asked what she thought about that book, and she said that she loved it. Now, any reasonable mother, if they read that book and they honestly believe the allegations to be true, would be truly disturbed. I think Virgie's comment saying that she loved that book says it speaks volumes for who she is.
Danny Lynn's going to have to read about all of this someday.
She is.
Not going to be easy.
It's going to be tough, and you don't know when, and you just hope that when it happens, somebody
will
be there to support.
Well, they learn to read fast.
They do.
You got a 7-year-old, 8-year-old, they read fluent.
Young kids talk. I can't even begin to fathom the types of schoolyard things that might be said about her and about Howard and about Larry. And
look how beautiful she is.
Anybody that thinks that Rita Cosby's done a service to Danny Lynn has a very perverted sense of justice.
On a lighter note, an email from Darcy in Wilmington, North Carolina. What's become of Anna Nicole's beloved dog, Sugar Pie?
Well, all the dogs are happy, healthy. They're with me right now. And Sugar Pie actually is probably going to have some cataract surgery. But all the dogs are getting along and they're doing well.
And
but
you are in both Beverly Hills, I mean in L.A. and Nassau?
In L.A. and Nassau. California is my residence. I go back and forth on a visitor's visa to Nassau. But the dogs are doing great. And, you know, they miss their mom just like I do.
And we only have 20 seconds. Why 60 million?
I think the complaint asked for at least 10 million in compensatory, at least 50 million in punitive. What they did to Howard Stern is egregious, and they should be punished and deterred from ever doing this to another individual.
You're confident.
I am. Mm.
Thank you both very much. Thanks for coming.
Thank you, Larry.
Howard K. Stern and Lynn Wood. We head you now to our website, cnn.com/Larry King. Upcoming guests are always listed there, and always you can send them an email question. You can also download our podcast or participate in a topical quick vote. It's all at one great website, cnn.com/Larry King. Tomorrow night, Stephen Colbert. And now Anderson Cooper and AC360. Anderson?